Good morning, Southern Hills United Methodist Church. Online worship service this morning. We are happy to see you. We're excited to be here. Won't you please join us as we worship together? This is my story and this is my song. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above echoes of mercy, of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Amen. Would you pray with me this morning? God, we'd come to you this morning to worship you, to lift your name up. God, I pray that you would be with each one of us, no matter where we are or what time we're tuning in to this worship service. God, I ask that we could just join our voices together and lift you up. I pray that you would guide us during these days, during these weeks and months of uncertainty. God, I pray that you would shine through each one of us every day in all of our interactions with our family, with our friends, with people we don't know. God, I pray that your light would be in us and that you would be seen in us. God, this morning I pray that we could come to know you better through this time of worship. I pray that we would encounter you this morning in our worship and in the preaching of your word. We thank you for this beautiful day you've given us. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Rumors of the Son of Man, stories of a Savior, and holiness with human hands, a treasure for the traitor. No ear has heard, no eye has seen the image of the Father. Until heaven came to live with me, a rescue like no other. You are worthy. You are worthy of your name. You are worthy, yes, you are. Thank you. ransom, my savior, my refuge, my hiding place. You're my helper, my healer, my blessed redeemer, my answer, my saving grace. You're my hope in the shadows, my strength in the battle, my anchor for all my days. And you stand by my side, you stood in my place, Jesus. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word is spoken to me, and I'm desperate for you. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very words spoken to me, and I'm desperate for you.
Peter. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is one true church, apostolic and universal, whose faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Creator, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all creation, and whose will is ever directed to our good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of humanity, the gift of God's unfailing grace and the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen.
All right, so when I was a kid, there were only certain times when the things that kids could watch came on television. I remember Saturday mornings, I would get up and I would be all excited because, you know, you could watch cartoons from about 7 o'clock, 7:30 in the morning until, I don't know, maybe 9:30 or 10 in the morning. And then you could watch cartoons for just a little while in the afternoon, most weekdays after school, from like, I don't know, maybe 3 to 4 o'clock or 4:30 or something like that. And I loved it, right? So I would come home from school, and I was allowed to have 3 cookies and watch one episode of a something, which was 30 minutes. You know, all the episodes of everything back then were 30 minutes long. Everything was 30 minutes long, right? And so I could have 3 cookies, and I could watch one episode of something. Usually it was something like G.I. Joe or the Transformers or something like that, and I'm convinced to this day that that has absolutely no impact on why I chose to go into the military. But I remember watching that, and I'd eat my 3 cookies. It is so hard to space 3 cookies out over a 30-minute time frame. No matter how long you dunk your cookie into the milk and leave it there, you can't do one cookie for 10 minutes at a time. And so I remember watching that, right? But in between segments, there would be these commercials, right? And commercials would be on about all kinds of things. But there was this one commercial set that was produced by the television station that the show that I was watching was on. It would have somebody come on. It'd be a celebrity from one of the evening sitcoms or something like that. And they would just share a really positive and encouraging message, something that would remind you to be good to people or something that would remind you to be kind to people. And then at the end of that, they would have this little star thing that went across the screen. You know what graphics were like back then. And they would say, "The more you know." I hadn't thought about that in years until about 2 months ago. I'm watching television, and all of a sudden, out of the blue, I mean, I hadn't seen these in years, right? Probably decades, and yet I've been watching TV, been watching plenty of TV. That's not the problem. I just hadn't seen these, right? And so a couple of months ago, there I am watching something, and one of the modern celebrities from one of the shows that's on all the time comes on, shares a really positive, kind, encouraging message. You know, remember to be kind to other people, remember to give grace to people. And then at the end of that, the little star went across the screen, and they said, "The more you know." And I had this flashback to my childhood that was a glorious moment for me. I even went into the next room, and I grabbed 3 cookies and came back out, sit down and eat together. All right, so we're working our way through this series called 7 Women and Their Secrets of Greatness, where we're spending some time learning about what spiritual greatness is. What is spiritual greatness, and how can we learn about spiritual greatness from the lives of each of these 7 incredible women? Today we're going to take a look at the life of Susanna Wesley, often called the mother of Methodism. Susanna would be mother to 19 children, 10 of whom would survive into adulthood, and 2 of whom would go on to found a denomination that in its various forms, and including the sub-denominations that trace their lineage back to her children, accounts for about 81 million people worldwide today. A denomination that is responsible for the end of the slave trade in England, the reformation of the penal system, for the end of child labor, and the ensuing child labor laws that would protect children for years and decades and generations to come, and the establishment of countless hospitals, and yes, even universities. Today we're going to learn about a woman who believed in the power of knowledge and in what it meant to prepare the next generation for great things by empowering them with that same knowledge. Let's take a look at what the scriptures have to say about what it means to have your spirit renewed by the transformation of your minds. Before we engage the scriptures, because they are holy, we should pray together. Let's do that now. Gracious and giving God, we are grateful for the ways in which you transform and renew our minds, the ways in which you renew our spirits by helping us, God, to be a people who are lifelong learners, who are always engaging opportunities to learn more about who you are and who you've called us to be, to learn more about how we can step into and live into the callings that you've placed upon our hearts and on our lives. We are so grateful for examples like that of Susanna Wesley, people who remind us that even when we face trial after trial after trial, we can rest in the hope of your providence, and we can rest in the knowledge that as we step into your calling, even in the midst of those trials, there are a few things that we can control. And those few things, when blessed by your greatness, have the power to change the world. Pray that your Holy Spirit would instruct us today, that we might learn as a result of our time together more about who you are and who you are calling us to be. Today's lesson comes out of Romans chapter 12. So, brothers and sisters, because of God's mercies, I encourage you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice that is holy and pleasing to God. This is your appropriate priestly service. Do not be conformed to the patterns of the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds so that you can figure out what God's will is, what is good and pleasing and mature. Because of the grace that God gave me, I can say to each one of you, don't think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. Instead, be reasonable. Since God has measured out a portion of faith to each one of you, we have many parts in one body, but the parts don't all have the same function. In the same way, though there are many of us, we are one body in Christ, and individually we belong to each other. We have different gifts that are consistent with God's grace that has been given to us. If your gift is prophecy, you should prophesy in proportion to your faith. If your gift is service, devote yourself to serving. If your gift is teaching, devote yourself to teaching. If your gift is encouragement, devote yourself to encouraging. The one giving should do it with no strings attached. The leader should lead with passion. The one showing mercy should be cheerful. Love should be shown without pretending. Hate evil and hold on to what is good. Love each other like the members of your family. Do be the best at showing honor to each other. Do not hesitate to be enthusiastic. Be on fire in the Spirit as you serve the Lord. Be happy in your hope. Stand your ground when you're in trouble and devote yourselves to prayer. Contribute to the needs of God's people and welcome strangers into your home. Bless people who harass you. Bless and don't curse them. Be happy with those who are happy and cry with those who are crying. Consider everyone as equal and don't think that you're better than anyone else. Instead, associate with people who have no status. Don't think that you are so smart. Don't pay back anyone for their evil actions with evil actions, but show respect for what everyone else believes is good. If possible, to the best of your ability, live at peace with all people. Don't try to get revenge for yourselves, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. Because it's written, "Revenge belongs to me. I will pay it back," says the Lord. Instead, if your enemy is hungry, feed them. If he is thirsty, give him a drink. By doing this, you will pile burning coals of fire upon his head. Don't be defeated by evil, but defeat evil with good. Jesus is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Well, our accompaniment's gone today, so you'll have to help me with the song. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. I wish you were gathered with me right here. As Dr. Scraper began this scripture, it starts out with those words, brothers and sisters. Oh, what a beautiful thing. Brothers and sisters, I wish you were here with me right now. Those words make me think of a great big family. A family that loves each other. A family that hugs each other. And right now we might be doing air hugs. But that's okay. It made me think of my best friend. When I was a young man, I was in about second grade, and my young friend, he lived across the street from me. His name was Bet-to-be. And Bet-to-be and I were inseparable. We were brothers. In fact, we did our very best to be brothers. He was a different color than me. He was an African-American young man, and he and I often put our hands side by side, and we'd look at each other's color. And after we looked at each other's color, we'd say, whose house are we sleeping at tonight? He'd spend the night at my house, and I would spend the night at his house. We spent many nights at each other's houses, and each house was different. He would come over to my house, and we would have pizza, and we'd play games, and then I'd go to his house, and my eyes were opened to a whole nother world. He called his mama, Mama. And when I came over, I said, what should I call your mama? And he said, you should call my mama, Mama. And I did. I called his mama, Mama. And his sisters and his brothers, I called sister and brother. And they hugged me and they loved me. And we ate together. I remember one of the meals that we ate at his house for the first time, I was puzzled by. We had hot links for dinner. And I was used to hot links, but we put them on the grill and we grilled them. They boiled them. It was different. And it had this broth that came out of it that was pink. Hot links are pink, and they turn the water when you boil them, they turn them pink. And then his mama, my mama when I was over at his house, she took that water and she poured it off of them, and she poured that water into the macaroni and boiled it. And the macaroni had a little bit of a pink to it also. And then we had some greens with it, and we had to eat the greens. And I found that I do actually like the greens, and I like macaroni cooked in hot link broth. And I enjoyed the hot links. He was my brother. He is my brother today. We are of two different skins. We are of two different cultures. But he taught me such a valuable lesson. Bet-to-be, I love you. You are my brother. I hope that our young folks today, when you look at the world around you, look around, and if someone is of a different color than you, of a different culture than you, if they are richer than you or poorer than you, or you just don't quite get them, remember that they are your brother or your sister, your mother or your father. That passage starts off, brothers and sisters. In Acts, I also read this week that we are all children of God. So, you've heard me say it. In fact, here around the church, I often greet everyone with brother or sister. Sometimes I like to call, especially the women of the church, mother. Sometimes I'll call one of our older brothers, I'll call them father, but it's not received as well. They kind of look at me like, I'm not sure about that. But the women usually take it well. Mother, I love you. When you see those around you, no matter what shade they are, where they come from, remember, we are of one family. We are all God's children. Reach your arms out to them. And we can't hug in full right now, which is killing me right now. So I've learned how to do something different. Reach your arms out like this and just say, air hugs. Can you do that with me out there? Reach out your arms. We're practicing. Air hugs. Give somebody an air hug and call them out. Call them out as a child of God. Say, you are my brother. You are my sister. You are my mother. You are my father. We are all children of God. Air hugs. I love you. Let's pray together. God bless all your children. Watch over us this day. Keep us, guide us, and grow us, and let us show the love of God as it has been shown to us. Let us be the hands and feet of God himself. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We have a mission moment today, and I'd like to share a little bit of about our mission as a church that we've been doing lately. We have been reaching out. I have to give praise and thanks and tell you about some wonderful people who have been doing just a wonderful job. Our congregational care team. And that's the group that many of you have had phone calls from, that have called you up on the phone, who have walked through that moment with you of how are you doing? What is it like in your house? Are you getting by? Do you have enough to eat? Can the church help you in any way? Could we deliver groceries to you? And then that most important question, how is it with your soul? This congregational care team has been reaching out to every member of the church. And if you haven't got a call from either the associate pastor or this congregational care team, I need you to call. I need you to call us up. I need you to call Michelle. And I need you to give us some information because it means your information in our computer is not right. And I've had a couple calls where I've either left you a message or I've gotten that signal that says that your phone is no longer connected with this number. So call us up. I'd love to visit with you or send one of our congregational care team to call you also. We aim to reach out. This is our mission. We aim to be a family. Call and talk with us. We come before God, and I've lifted these up in prayer. I also want to lift up all of our staff that have supported us in this time. They do a wonderful job. And you at home, we come together and we lift you up. And we also come together to give our tithes and our gifts together. Would you pray with me? God, we worship you. We come before you with humble hearts as one family. Destined to do one common good, to spread the love of God throughout the world. Let us raise our hearts in thanks and praise and thanksgiving, and also to give good gifts and sacrifices. Be with us this day. Let the gifts that we give, the sacrifices that we make, the offerings and the tithes, let them grow your kingdom right here. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
By grace alone, somehow I stand, where even angels fear to tread. Invited by redeeming love, before the throne of God above. He pulls me close with nail-scarred hands into his everlasting arms. When condemnation grips,
lips my heart, and Satan tempts me to despair. I hear the voice that scatters fear, the great I am, the Lord is here. Oh, praise the one who fights for me and shields my soul eternally. Boldly I approach your throne, blameless now I'm running.
She was born in 1669, the 25th of 25 children. And she was born amidst a backdrop of controversy and turmoil that was rampaging England at the time. See, there was a controversy that was brewing between the Puritans and the Church of England. It was a controversy that would make its way all the way up to the throne as, for a time, Oliver Cromwell, who was the leader of the Puritanical movement in that era, would end up overthrowing the crown and becoming the ruler of England for almost 10 years before, at his death, the royal party would gain power again. And Charles II would end up being the King of England. When Charles II became the King of England, he reversed the fortunes of the Puritans. And he proclaimed that no one who was not a member of the Church of England would be allowed to preach within the country. Now, in various forms, that act that he passed, which would end up being repealed 10 years later, it would survive in some capacity, and it is much the reason that John Wesley was fearful of beginning a new denomination almost 75 years later. The controversy that was brewing at that time would be the reason that so many Puritans left the British Isles to seek a new life free from religious persecution in America. So this is the context, this is the setting into which Susanna Wesley was born. Now, she wasn't born Susanna Wesley. She was born Susanna Ainslie. She was the daughter of Reverend Samuel Ainslie and her mother, Mary. Samuel was a Puritan. He was a Puritanical preacher. And so when this act was passed that said that no Puritan ministers would be allowed to preach, several of them did so anyway. And in fact, her father was thrown in prison for a little while for doing so. Most of that time, he just had no source of income. So from a very early age, if you can imagine this, being the 25th of 25 children, can you imagine being in a home with 25 children in it? I grew up in a household where there were three of us. And boy, did we keep our parents on their toes. I can't imagine being in a home with 24 other siblings. That just blows my mind. But can you imagine trying to feed 25 children, especially when you have absolutely no source of income to rely upon? Susanna Wesley knew from an early age what it meant to deal with the trials and tribulations of regular life in Western Europe. She didn't come from a wealthy family. She didn't come from a family that had a royal heritage, at least not an earthly one. She didn't come from a family where significant amounts of money would be passed on. She came from a family that knew what it meant to trudge out a living in the daily life of 17th century England. She came from a family that knew hardship. She came from a family that understood what it meant to lose a large number of children early in life. Later in her life, Susanna Wesley would lose 9 of her 19 children in infancy. Can you imagine that? If she had experienced no other hardship in her life, would that not have been enough? I know people, as do you, who have lost a child, who've lost a sibling, lost a parent or a grandparent, lost a niece, lost a nephew. I don't know anyone who's lost 9 children. If that were the only trial that she endured, would that not have been enough? And yet Susanna Wesley would grow up in a time when her father's faith was illegal, at least for a time. That act would be repealed, and her father would end up finding his way into a parish again during her lifetime. But early in life, she would know hardship. She grew up in a time when it was not customary to teach women. Women didn't know in large numbers how to read or how to write. That was not common. What was common to teach a woman were what were considered during that era to be the womanly duties of the household. And so from an early age, women were taught how to do the cooking and the cleaning and the sewing, how to raise crops and herbs locally in the field, how to manage their household. They were taught the duties that were normative during that time. They were not taught how to read, and they were not taught how to write, at least not in large numbers. Now, it wasn't illegal to do so. It just wasn't normal to do so either. And that's what made it so strange, that Susanna's father encouraged her. He sat down and he taught her how to read and he taught her how to write. And he did that before she was allowed to learn any of her other duties. And that would stick with her for the rest of her life. Later, as an adult woman with her own children, she made it a point to ensure that her daughters learned to read and write before they were allowed to learn any of the other duties that would have been considered normal for a woman to learn during that time, a result of the fact that her father had spent time teaching her to read and write and then encouraged her to read from his extensive library. She grew up listening to great theological discussions taking place in her childhood home, between her father and people that you would know, people like Daniel Defoe, who was the author of the book Robinson Crusoe, who used to sit inside of her father's library and discuss theological issues together with him. She would listen to those things, and she would read, and she would learn. It came to be said of her later in life that she was most likely much better educated than most of the ministers that she encountered during her lifetime. Had she not experienced any other trial, growing up in abject poverty, amidst a backdrop of a political situation in which her father's faith was illegal, at least for a time, and then later in life losing 9 of 19 children. And yet that would be only the tip of the iceberg for a person like Susanna Wesley, who went through trial after trial after trial. It was a strange thing, at least it seems strange, given her father's predisposition, that she would decide to join the Church of England. It was a testimony to the kind of parents she had that they even allowed her to do so. Her father being a Puritan, she chose to join the Church of England, which was a result of her theological readings and reflection and listening to her father discuss his theological position with other people who frequented their home. She didn't dislike her father. She loved her father and she loved her mother and would until the day that she died. And yet she came to believe that the Church of England was the right place for her. That belief would be reflected in the life of her son, John Wesley, who became an Anglican priest, a priest in the Church of England, and who would stray far and wide from a Christian theological perspective. He would go look at other Christian traditions, trying to find the theology of grace that he would eventually develop. And he would write in his journal, he would say, "I went from place to place and group to group, from Christian group to Christian group, and I learned many things that helped me tremendously, but it was back in my own beloved Church of England," he would say, "where I found the theology that I had been looking for all those years that helped me to understand we are saved by God's grace, not by our own works." She would become a member of the Church of England, falling in love with another young man, also named Samuel, who would come to be a priest in the Church of England. They would correspond for 6 years, until she was 19 and he had finished his theological education and taken a job as a local rector in a very small parish. Feeling free to marry, they did so, having only really known each other through the correspondence in their letters. When they got married, they came to find that aside from their love of the Church of England and their innate stubbornness that they both shared, they didn't have very much else in common with one another. And that would plague them throughout their lifetimes. In fact, her husband, Samuel Wesley, would end up spending a lifetime unable to hold a job for very long. Early, just a few months into his job as a rector at his first parish, he let go of that job and went to go serve as a naval chaplain on a ship, an English ship. A few months after that, giving up that position because he said the food was terrible and he was horribly mistreated, and then he couldn't find work for a while. So by this time, his wife, Susanna, who was pregnant with their first child, had to go live in a boarding house because they couldn't afford a place for her to live. And then when he came back from sea, they both went to go live with her parents for a time until the child was born. That would be the norm for her husband, Samuel Wesley. Now, if that were not enough, as he goes from job to job, unable to hold down positions, going going from that job to a job as a curate, which basically means, at that time, an associate minister, trying to supplement his work in the church with other things because his salary was so meager, and yet his senior pastor, the rector of that church, would not allow him to engage in other work and fired him from doing so. He would go from job to job to job to job, unable to provide for his family. As if that were not enough of a trial, Susanna grew up during a time and lived during a time when women were not allowed to earn their own income. She was beholden to the work ethic and the ability and the financial station of the men in her life, men like her husband and like her father, whom she loved dearly, who had the wisdom to bless his daughter and allow her. During that time, she had to be allowed by her father to join the Church of England. But he was resentful enough of that that he would not leave a penny to her in inheritance on the day that he died. Susanna grew up during a time when not only were women not educated, they were not allowed to provide for themselves. By the grace of God, I can't help but be grateful. Though there is work that needs to be done, I am grateful for the pioneers who have brought us to at least where we are today. I just ordered a shirt for my wife that I ordered because she sent me a link and said, order me the shirt. And so it's a shirt that says, it's 2020, 100 years since women were given the right to vote, and I don't intend to take that right for granted. It's a great shirt. Can't wait for it to come in the mail. I am so grateful for the pioneers who have made things different. Is there work that needs to be done? Absolutely there is. But I'm grateful for the hard work of the people who saw that things could change, who approached the trials of life, the storms of life, which are inevitable for all of us, whether you grew up in the time of Susanna Wesley, which you didn't, or not. We all experience the storms of life. They come to each of us in our own time and in their own way. And yet it was pioneers like Susanna Wesley who would approach calamity after calamity after calamity and choose, as spiritual greatness does, to get better instead of growing bitter. I believe that is the first lesson about spiritual greatness that we can pull from the life of Susanna Wesley. Spiritual greatness chooses when faced with the trials of life, when faced with the inevitable storms that arise throughout anyone's lifetime, when faced maybe with calamity after calamity after calamity, spiritual greatness chooses to get better instead of growing bitter. Because spiritually great people understand that while they cannot always control the circumstances that lead to the storms that are an inevitable part of life, there are a couple of things that they can control. And so in approaching those storms, they do what Susanna Wesley did. Susanna Wesley would later write, after going through issue after issue, you know, not only did she grow up in poverty, not only did she grow up in a time when to be a Puritan was illegal, not only did she lose 9 of 19 children, not only did her husband struggle to find work, not only was she not allowed to provide for herself. Wouldn't that be enough? No, there was also this. Not only did she lose 1 home to fire, she lost 2. And in the second of those, she thought she had lost 3 children. In the first of them, she lost her home to fire after having been abandoned by her husband for a 12-month period because they disagreed about who should be the King of England. They're sitting at dinner one night, and she didn't think that the current king, who was actually of Dutch ancestry, should be the king. He was called often the Prince of Orange at the time. Most of England didn't think that, but her husband did. And so she wouldn't say an amen in his name. And her husband got so angry, he got up, walked out on her, the family, and his parish for 12 months. wouldn't come back. During that time, her home burned to the ground. It was actually the burning of the home that brought him back to build another home. And then later in life, their second home would burn completely to the ground, during which she thought she had lost three of her children. Two of them were saved by a servant who broke a window and threw them out the window. The last was her son, John, whom she called Jackie. Her husband had gone into the home to try to find him, couldn't find him. They thought he was lost. And then lo and behold, out of a second floor window, they saw him waving his hand. They climbed up to the outside of the house and pulled him out. And she would always say after that to John that he was destined to do something great, that God had something profound in mind for her son, Jackie, whom the rest of the world would come to know as John Wesley, the founder. Trial after trial after trial. And yet in the midst of those trials, after her second home had been burned, she wrote in her journal, "Dear Lord, as I face calamity, help me to do so in a way, get this, that makes it easier for me to relate to the trials and the struggles of other people with a heart of charity." Spiritual greatness doesn't come to be what it is because it does not endure tragedy. Spiritual greatness isn't spiritual greatness because there's never any trial in its lifetime, because there's never any tribulation, because there are no storms. No, spiritual greatness is spiritual greatness because spiritually great people approach calamity after calamity after calamity with an attitude that chooses to get better instead of growing bitter, and chooses to do so by looking at the few things that can be controlled, often in the midst of many things that cannot. I think, friends, that brings us to the second lesson that we can pull from the life of Susanna Wesley about what spiritual greatness is. Susanna could control a couple of things. She couldn't control a society in which she was not allowed to earn her own income. She couldn't control whether or not her husband would be able to hold down a job. She couldn't control how many times her house would burn down, save for the fact that after the second time, they built the next house out of brick. But there were things she could control. And the first of them was whom she would choose to be. Not only as a result of, but in the midst of the life she had been called to live. In the midst of the path that had been laid out before her, she could choose who she would be. So who did Susanna Wesley choose that she would be? Susanna Wesley knew from an early age that knowledge was its own kind of power. That, I think, is the second lesson about spiritual greatness. Spiritual greatness is studious. Spiritually great people know that knowledge is its own kind of power. Now, it can certainly be the kind of power that enables you to laud that power over other people, but that's not how spiritually great people approach knowledge, because they know that there is another kind of power that comes from learning. They know that there is a power that comes from adopting an attitude that you will be a lifelong learner. They know that there is a kind of power that comes from discerning together with God what kind of knowledge is necessary to attain in order to step into what you have been called to do and live the life that you have been called to live. Susanna Wesley knew, probably because she grew up in a time when it was just not common for a woman to be educated. And yet she saw the benefits that could come from knowing how to read and write, from reading the great works from history, from reading the great theological treatises. She saw that with that knowledge came the ability to pass that knowledge on and use it in constructive and powerful ways, that oftentimes the Holy Spirit would work through that knowledge to accomplish amazing things. I remember sitting in a seminary class, a preaching class, and we were being taught how to preach by someone who I still happen to think is a tremendous preacher and public speaker. And he told us this story when we were talking about what ministers will inevitably talk about in a preaching class. We had been working our way through the text. We were all given a text to preach, and there were some in our class who decided to cite a verse in the scripture where Jesus says, "Don't prepare ahead of time what you'll say. You'll be given the words by the Holy Spirit." And so this particular young student had come to the day that he was supposed to preach for a grade without having prepared a sermon on his text. He was just going to wing it, trusting in the power of the Holy Spirit to give him the words that he needed to speak. Now, does that mean that the Holy Spirit cannot, does not, and will not give you the words to speak? Absolutely not. No, the Holy Spirit does what the Holy Spirit will. He preached his sermon, and the room was quiet. And when asked by the professor how he had prepared, he shared this story. "I didn't prepare. Jesus says, don't prepare. The Holy Spirit will give you the words to speak." Professor was quiet for a minute, looked back at the young man and said, "Well, let me just say that it is a shame that you did not give the Holy Spirit more to work with." Friends, we are called often to a time of preparation, no matter what your calling is. Can the Holy Spirit download into you all knowledge that is necessary for everything ever? Absolutely. What do we normally experience? That the Holy Spirit calls you into a time of preparation for what you've been called to do. Knowledge is its own kind of power. When you seek to be prepared according to the way that the Holy Spirit has called you to live your life and the calling the Holy Spirit has brought you into and is encouraging you to step into, when you choose to prepare according to your call, the Holy Spirit will bless that knowledge tenfold and use it in powerfully constructive ways. What is it that you've been called to do? And how are you being called into a time of preparation for that? For some reason, recently, I've seen a number of memes come across my social media feed denigrating people who are educated, saying things like, "I know people who have bachelor's degrees who are idiots," or something of the like. I'm probably foremost among those idiots. But I also tend to think that Susanna Wesley might have taken a different approach, that Susanna Wesley, who grew up in a time when women could not be educated, might take a look at some of those memes and say to us, "Let's not shame people who 100 or 200 years ago were not allowed to be educated. Let's encourage them in learning what can and should be learned so that they can be better equipped for the call that God has placed on their hearts." Spiritual greatness is studious. It adopts a position as a lifelong learner and discerns together with God what kind of knowledge, what kind of preparation is necessary for the call that God has placed on the heart of the person that is seeking to be a lifelong learner. In the midst of calamity after calamity after calamity, spiritual greatness chooses to get better instead of growing bitter. How does Susanna Wesley do that? By controlling what she can control. What can she control? She can control who she will be. She chooses to be an educated person, a person who takes that calling that God has placed on her heart and adequately prepares herself to live into it. And then she is a person who chooses to control what she will do, even in the midst of the suffocating circumstances that she finds herself. I think that's the last lesson we can pull from her life, at least this morning. My goodness, we could talk about her life forever. Spiritual greatness chooses to equip the next generation to be the kind of link in the generational chain that is going to be necessary for the time in which that link will be forged. You know, it's a natural human tendency to be afraid. As we grow older, we come to be afraid that we'll be forgotten. We come to be afraid that we're no longer relevant, that we're no longer wanted. The world begins to pass us by. It's normal for us to be afraid. It's normal then for us to fall into the trap of trying to ensure that the next link in the generational chain is forged in exactly the same way that our link in the generational chain was forged. And yet, spiritual greatness knows that our link in the generational chain, and this is a chain, friends, to use that metaphor, that was forged long before you and I were here. And it will continue to be forged long after we are gone. If we were able to forge a strong chain in our generation, then it is only because the people who came before us had the wisdom to know that we would need to be equipped to forge the chain, the link in the chain that would need to be forged in our time. So they took great pains to make sure that we were equipped to forge the kind of link that would need to be forged according to how the world works today. Susanna Wesley knew that in order for the next link in the generational chain to be strong, that those who would forge it in the next generation would need to be well equipped to forge a strong link in the time that they would need to forge it. And she knew that that link would be different from the link that was forged in her time. She also knew that if she prepared them well, and this was her call, let no one ever tell you that a life spent planting the kinds of seeds in the next generation that allow for the forging of a strong link in that chain is a life that has been misspent, because nothing could be further from the truth. She knew that in order for things to change in the future, those links would have to be forged differently in each generation. What is it that Susanna Wesley wanted to change in the future? I don't know. Maybe she wanted to see a future where women could be educated, where maybe that was the norm instead of the exception, where women were encouraged not only to be educated, but to have and take opportunities to be able to provide for themselves and their families. She would take that knowledge, and in the midst of calamity after calamity, instead of growing bitter, she chose to do what God was calling her to do to help make things better. Would she see that in her lifetime? Not all of it, but some of it. She would pass that knowledge on to her children, making sure that they learned Greek and Latin. She would teach them 3 hours in the morning and 3 hours in the afternoon, and when she felt like the texts that they had were inadequate, she wrote her own. At least 2 of them for her children to study. She would make sure that the next generation was equipped to forge a strong chain, and a strong chain would they forge. In her lifetime, she would see them go on to begin a new denomination, and that denomination and the people in it and its influence would grow beyond her lifetime. In her lifetime, she would come to know that her son was working to the end of the slave trade. After she died, the slave trade in England would end. There would be a reform to the penal codes so that people would be treated better even in their incarceration. There would be educational reform, and there would be reform to child labor laws, and the denomination that her children would found would grow on to grow today to be over 80 million people, with countless hospitals and societies dedicated to reaching out to the marginalized and oppressed. And get this, numerous universities where young women and young men would be educated and prepared to be strong links in the next generational chain. About 200 years after she died, the denomination that calls her its mother would be among the first to ordain women. Her husband was away doing one of the things that he does And they brought in another minister by the name of Inman, the Reverend Inman, and everybody hated his preaching. He was like no pun intended, a god-awful preacher. He was terrible. Nobody wanted to listen to him. So she, Susanna, started to have gatherings in her home on Sunday afternoon where she would read sermons that had been written either by her father or by her husband. Well, more people started coming to these meetings than were going to church on Sunday morning. They quit going to church and started going there to the point that the Reverend Inman wrote a letter to her husband saying, hey, she's having an illegal meeting. And he wrote a letter to his wife saying, hey, women can't read sermons. Maybe you should have a man do it. Susanna fired off a response. And it said something like this. If you want me to stop, then you make sure to send me a letter back with that direction in the most explicit terms so that when I stand in front of God, it'll be you that's on the hook for making me quitting to do this. He didn't fire that back. She kept reading. And when he came home, he found that his congregation had grown as a result of what she did, and people liked the Wesleys better as a result of what she had chosen to do. That became the form for the class meetings that would come to be the small groups of Methodism. Spiritual greatness chooses to get better instead of growing bitter. What are the calamities that you're facing or that you face? Maybe it's been one after another, and maybe they've all been brought on by circumstances that you can't control. And you're frustrated about that, and why wouldn't you be? When you're dealing with issue after issue, storm after storm, trial after trial, and all of it's being brought on seemingly by things outside of your control, why wouldn't you grow bitter? Because there's an alternative. And that alternative is to choose to control what you can. Well, what can I control? Like Susanna Wesley, you can control who you'll be and what you will do. Maybe your circumstances are so restrictive that the only thing you can do is prepare the next generation to forge a strong leak so that generation can prepare the next and the next and the next, and maybe the changes that you should have been blessed to see in your lifetime will finally start to be affected generations from now because you chose to get better instead of growing. Pray with me. God, we are so grateful for the example of a strong woman like Susanna Wesley, the mother of the Methodist Church. We're so grateful that even though she had setback after setback after setback, she chose, God, that she would get better instead of growing bitter, that she would control what you gave her to control. She decided who she would be, and she became a lifelong learner among the most educated of all the ministers. That she chose to control what she would do. Knowing how restricted her life was, she chose to create a chain, a link in the chain that would allow for the possibility of a different and a new link to be formed so that new links could be formed after that, so that one day things could and would be different. Thank you, God, for her faithfulness. Thank you for her example. Thank you for her wisdom. And thank you for her legacy. Let us become a people who will follow that example, who will, in the midst of things we cannot control, choose to get better, choose to be lifelong learners, choose to prepare the next generation, not for what we had to do, but for what they will have to do. All of this we ask in the name of your Son, who is our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses. just as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. Compares to this, what a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. He didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. Silence the